feel like we're judges at American Idol.
We're judging you.
It's very strange.
Thank you all for coming out tonight. It's great to see you here. And you know, but I will introduce again. This is Terje Rød-Larsen, who is the main character of the play, and today is the president of the International Peace Institute, but was very much behind the secret negotiations that led to Oslo. And this is J.T. Rogers, playwright extraordinaire and friend. I first met him on Blood and Gifts, which was at Lincoln Center about Afghanistan. He's the playwright, and we have Bartlett Sher, also a fantastic director who I'm sure all of you have seen many of his shows, and also was the director at Blood and Gifts, where I met both of them. And so we're going to just begin with a short few questions, and then we're going to open with one of the scenes. Then we'll return to questions and have a few more scenes for you. So let's start with you, JT.
Yes.
How did this play come about? What inspired you to take it upon yourself to tackle Oslo?
The answer that is also, it feels sort of kismet that we're all here tonight together, because it happened from meeting Taya, and I met Taya the same week that I met you. That when Bart was directing the American premiere of my play, Blood and Gifts, at Lincoln Center, and we both realized we'd like to bring in experts to sort of give context for actors when they're doing a historical or political play. And through friends and colleagues, I brought in Elizabeth, who had been a journalist covering Afghanistan during the American wars there. And Bart knew Taya, the international diplomat, originally through they had children who went to the same school. And so here we are with both of you tonight. Only in a play could that happen. So what happened was, from my end, Taya came to meet some of the actors, because Blood and Gifts is about Afghanistan and CIA agents and operatives, and there's a lot of diplomacy in it. And Bart wanted him to come talk about international diplomacy, which was utterly fascinating to hear his stories. And he had read the play and was very kind about it and thought I was a journalist, which I took, you know, I was very chuffed. And then he came to the play and loved it, and Bart set up the two of us to have a drink after the show. And I think Bart said, oh, you should, you know, get him to talk about his work in Israel, Palestine, et cetera. And you were, I think, savvy enough, knowing my headstrongness, not to say, oh, you know, you should think about this for a play. Just talk to him about it. So we went out for drinks, and I started asking questions. And like a good diplomat, he's always wanted to talk about, sort of deflect the glare to other people. But I started thinking, so what about you, though? What did you have to do with this? And the seed was planted that night at P.J. Clark's. I think we had martinis, I think, if I remember correctly. And I was fascinated, because I don't want to speak for all of you, but I'm sure a lot of you are political junkies like myself, and you think you know a lot about what's going on in the world. But I didn't understand that there had been this channel behind the channel, as it were, with the Oslo Peace Accords. For my sins, I thought all along that we had done that. How's that for honesty? And so, of course, that fascinated me, and then I sort of was off to the races, and I went to Norway and met Taya there, and I went to see the locations that much of the play takes place in, and then I sort of had to go off on my own and read all the memoirs and research and travel, and then make a play that tried to convey the spirit, as I understood it, what happened, and something that was sort of a ruthlessly accurate, but a fiction at the same time. It's my play, not in any way a verbatim recreation of what happened. And that's sort of the long and the short of it from my end.
And I guess I would follow up with Taya here. What, you know, given that you're putting yourself in the hands of a playwright who is going to do what he may, right, with the things that you tell him, what inspired you, what gave you the confidence and the desire to tell the story, have it be told in a theatrical setting, and in a way to relinquish control of it?
Actually, I had not read the manuscript or seen it before I was invited to see the play.
Can you hear?
So oops. Hold on.
Is it better now?
Yeah.
No, I'd actually never read the manuscript or seen anything of it before I was invited to the premiere. So it was risky business.
I'm not sure who, was he more nervous watching it? Was I more nervous watching him watch it?
Yes, but we couldn't let him, by the way, just so you understand, we would love to have had him see it, but on the other hand, that's a longer conversation. It's important that he write his play, and Taya was so generous, he didn't feel he could tell us, you know, exactly, you know, it follows the order of events, et cetera, but it has to be dramatized, so it was intense.
Yeah, and I must say I was, I shouldn't say I was pleasantly surprised, but I mean, the play is 3 hours, is it? So it's basically comprising something which happened very intensely over 8 months into 3 hours. Yeah. I mean, that's a challenge. And I think these two guys have done it masterfully well. Of course, it's not a documentary, so it doesn't reflect on many instances what actually happened, and actually some of the things you are putting into the play didn't happen the way you are putting it into the play, but that's beside the point, because you are not writing history or producing a documentary. What I think you've done so masterfully is to catch the spirit of Oslo, and I think you are spot on in a way you've done it. And I think the most important thing, if there is a message in the play, is that it is possible to do the impossible, and that there is hope. Mm. Because in a way, everybody thought it was impossible to do it, and it portrayed, when the agreement was there, a ray of hope throughout the region and beyond. And I think this is something you, as I said, something you've caught masterfully in the play. I said 8 months, but actually there is a kind of prehistory of Oslo which goes over many, many years, and in a way this is also encompassed in the play. I could go on and on and talk about this.
We'll do that in the next, after we've seen at least the first scene. But Bartlett, I would ask you, you know, in getting this very intense play before you, What were the themes that you wanted to bring out and that you also wanted an audience to take away?
Well, I wouldn't say theme. First of all, what's great about Oslo is it's, as a delivery system for an entertainment, which you might spend a lot of money to see, it's essentially an intellectual thriller. Mm-hmm. So you have these two extraordinary people, Terje Rød-Larsen and his wife Mona Juul, who independently and mostly inspired by Taya, decide that they're going to start a secret back channel negotiation between the Israelis and the Palestinians without the permission of their own government, mm-hmm. in Norway, and without the formal permission of either the Palestinians or Israelis, and bring them secretly to a secret location in Norway, and within 8 months come up with the only peace agreement in the history of the region. So from the point of view of a dramatist and a director, you know,
it's pretty good.
It could be fun, yeah. So you watch this thing unspool, and what's kind of a shame is that there are so many extraordinary stories from those 7 or 8 months that aren't captured in the show. But the alternate conversation, and you learn from Taya that everything is like two or three levels in every conversation, is that it gives you another opportunity to relearn the history of the region, relearn what the stakes are, and rewatch people who hate each other horribly mm-hmm. try to come to some kind of agreement. And it's not the Affordable Care Act. It's, you know, so it's a very interesting thing to watch happen. So it has all this. It has all the stuff of great theater and great drama.
Yeah.
And the purpose. And like great history plays. So for your opportunity to explore and experience a period of time and see some heroism, and as Taya said, which is the thing we're looking for, hope, actual hope for peace, for agreement, for lots of things.
I guess, JT, you know, I was thinking in how there were so many different ways you could have gone. And what made you decide to, obviously this Taya is the first person that you spoke to, and it's how you came to it. But what made you decide to, the play is really, Taya and Mona, his wife, are kind of the framers, you know, for the play.
Yeah, that's a good word for it. Yeah,
and what framers. Made you decide to do that?
I'm sure, just by partially, you know, any luck, pluck and virtue when you're writing anything, and I think there's always the fact that I stumbled upon it through a Norwegian is going to be some of that. But I think I couldn't have answered what I'm going to tell you now a year ago, because as you know, as a writer, sometimes you have to get done with something to realize why you were doing it,
yeah,
or how, why it is that you did it a certain way. I had, you know, I, as a writer of plays and now film and TV, that what interests me is politics and history and human beings struggling against that, and sort of the blood and the sex and the humor and life. I always have, you have a series of subjects, you think, oh, I'd like to write a play about X. But you can never write a play about X, you have to find a personal story, otherwise it's in. And so, like I'm sure many, many playwrights and novelists, you sit around in the back of your mind and say, someday I'd like to write a play about the Middle East. And you think, well, one, that's a big topic, and two, I don't want to get killed, you know? And how do you tell us? And then so the thing that was so hairs going up on the back of my neck when I started to learn about the story, I said, oh, that's a framing device that allows both an American audience into the story, but more selfishly allows me to have a framing device that would allow me to fall into that story and right, tell it, not as a lecture, not as an essay, but as a, you know, a confounding, human, hopefully moving, surprising story about people.
How did you feel, Taya, about the portrayal of yourself on the stage that first night?
Well, that's a very hard question, actually. the actor is terrific, by the way. It's not entirely me, I would say. Yeah. It's a different person than.
Yeah, no, it's true. I think it's myself. I think, and you've been very generous.
That's beside
about
the point. As I said earlier, it's not a documentary. You're not writing history. You're trying to catch the spirit. And you do that indeed. And the point is not to portray the different characters as they were, because none of them were exactly, and it's impossible to do it. But the point is that there is you've created, both of you, a dynamism in the play, which is more or less precisely the dynamism which we are in the talks. So. I'm a kind of funny guy in the play, but maybe I'm not so funny in real life. I felt very comfortable with it. I mean, as I said, even though, I mean, some of the scenes did not take place the way you portray it, but again, the kind of the main outline, the spirit of it, is very correct.
What was the most challenging thing for you to stage in staging this? I mean, one of the things I noticed, because I've read it, but I have not seen it yet, and it is so fast-paced, I don't know how, if any of you have seen it yet, but it moves very quickly, but there's this interesting, you have Mona, which is Taya's wife and a diplomat, often looking out to the audience and telling us things. And there's a very carefully choreographed balance between narration and drama. And I wonder how you pulled that off on the stage.
there are 64 scenes, mm-hmm. So it moves extremely quickly. Mm-hmm. It's stylized in a kind of way like a great French drama would be, where you'd be doing a scene and you'd have an aside and you'd do a scene and you'd come back out. So mm-hmm. it I think audiences are so sophisticated now with narrative, yeah. They're able to keep how many ever windows open on their laptop at the same time. They're able to like have this conversation and talk to that person and be on the texting and do all. So you, in a weird way, we're trying to create a drama in which that many things are happening all at the same time. Yeah. So they can fill the whole screen and allow them to kind of move through the narrative really precisely. So I don't know about hard, because I have great actors and the support of Lincoln Center Theater and all that, but it's mostly just finding more and more ways to get from one place to the next mm-hmm. without any stopping, like a movie. So it just clicks and clicks and clicks and clicks and clicks.
And your working process, how do you two, would you say that there are things that, did you end up having to change things watching Bart try to
I mean, that's the joy of rehearsal. I mean, stepping back, one of the things that was really extraordinary for me in the making of this play was that I'd never had this experience, as I'm described to you, is I'd done a play at Lincoln Center. It had been a wonderful experience. We'd worked together and thought, oh, well, we have to do a lot together. We're on the same page. That's exciting. And the theater, and Andre Bishop, as its leader, said to me, basically, whatever you write next, we'll do, which is so empowering, to use a terrible but apt word of the moment, for a writer. So I had that, but more specifically, I knew who was going to direct the play and what his remark, you know, his ability. Well, you talk about the fluidity and the speed and the sort of choreography. Bart really is, there has no equal in that in the American theater. So, and I knew the designers, I knew some of the actors I was going to use in that same cast in Blood and Gifts. So I had this extraordinary starting block, and I knew that one of the reasons, again, in hindsight, but one of the reasons the play is so speedy and covers so much ground, literally and figuratively, is that I knew that the director in question could do anything I gave him. Mm-hmm. And that was, you know, that gave you a lot of confidence as a writer. But having said that, in, you know, we would be doing it and go, well, okay, this was funny on the page, but maybe not so funny on stage. And then, you know, we realized that certain things were out of order, and Bart has a great dramaturgical sense of sort of coming back, and he doesn't say, I don't understand, or what is this scene about? He works it until he figures out what it's about. And my sort of working rule now is, if he can't figure it out, then it's probably my responsibility to change it. Because
That's good that you worked that out.
Except those days when you're really doing bad work. Yeah, I know. No, because we are very different artists, both in, I'm a creative or generative creative artist, he's an interpretive artist, but also we come from different places in the country and backgrounds. But we have so much that overlaps in terms of what we're interested in, both just the rhythm of language and ideas, that when we're working together, I don't have to go, see, this is what I intended, why these punctuations here. He just knows it, so then we can just move beyond that and try to get deeper into it.
Whenever I get a new script, the first thing, I don't suddenly start fixing the script, because mm-hmm. then I'm writing the script. Right. I have to explore it, work on it, and then if I've worked on it a while, I can say, you know what, I can't get this scene to work, maybe, I don't know, or something will become clear, mm-hmm. but only after you've been with it for a while.
I would just like another scene now.
Yeah,
going?
Yeah. Well, it's a thriller. I told you, we're doing an intellectual thriller, and it's setup for a
fantastic.
Thriller.
Fantastic. That was amazing.
So, and then we cut from there back to the beginning of the journey
right.
as to when that happened. I mean, Taya can tell you why they planned that whole dinner for all that to happen, if I'm not mistaken, right?
Taya, can you please tell us exactly what happened?
Yeah, actually, this is a scene which is more or less precisely the way it happened. We invited Marianne and Johan Jürgen for dinner. He was then Minister for Defense and was just about to take over as Foreign Minister. And we were close friends, and so of course we had to tell him before he assumed his new position what we were. Had been doing, and I couldn't believe it. And actually, that telephone call took place more or less precisely as because we had agreed with the Palestinians and the Israelis in order to avoid eavesdropping that we never used names. So we had agreed on a code. So Peres was the father, Yossi Beilin, who was deputy foreign minister at the time, was the son. And Rabin was the grandfather, and then it was the same way on the Palestinian side, where Arafat was the grandfather, the chief negotiator, Abu Allah, was the father, and then his assistant was the son, etc. So we used these very simple, we never used names. For some reason, actually, the intelligence services did not pick it up. But it sounded, of course, completely ridiculous when the incoming foreign minister was sitting listening to this funny conversation with the sons and the fathers and the grandfathers. So, so it was.
But didn't you set it up so that they would actually be there, he would be there, host would be there when the phone calls happened, or no?
No, it was incidental that the telephone calls came. So, I mean, we felt very awkward. So, I mean, the dinner was progressing. And we were kind of searching at the point of time where it could be natural to inform about.
Speaking of chicken, I have something to tell you.
Suddenly, this telephone call comes, and then we had no choice.
And was that the first telephone call in which both sides agreed?
No. We'd been doing this for a fairly long time. We started actually a year before.
But there'd been no meeting, or there had been before?
Yes, there had been meetings.
There had, okay.
Because the reason why, it looks kind of strange, because at the time, you could not call Israel from any Arab country. It was blocked because of the boycotting of Israel. So the Palestinians and the Israelis, they could not speak directly to each other. I mean, the Palestinians, the PLO, and Arafat was in exile in Tunis. So they had to call via us. So the Israelis would call our home telephone in Oslo, or my office phone, and then I will pass on the messages by calling Tunis and the other way around. So this is why this kind of telephone diplomacy was absolutely necessary at the time.
I just have to ask another question because of time. But, you know, so we get some of it in the play, but what made you and Mona think that you could just do this and have nobody behind you?
Now, it's a kind of, if I can use a minute on it, most things in life are incidental. Mm-hmm. So Mona is a career diplomat, she got her first posting to Cairo, and she we had a, we thought we were going to that she was going to be sent to Argentina, and had prepared ourselves to learn Spanish, etc. And I remember she cried when she was told she was being posted to Cairo. We had never been in the Middle East before, so I took a sabbatical for the institute which I was heading at the time, FAFO, and went with her to Cairo, and I had a hell of a nice time for 2 months, and then got bored to death. We were invited to a reception somewhere, and then I saw a guy who I thought was Arafat, and then it turned out because it was a spitting image, and it turned out that it was his brother Fatih Arafat, who was the head of the Palestinian Red Crescent in Cairo and had a Palestinian hospital in Cairo. And I thought, oh my God, this is Arafat's brother, he must be an interesting guy. So I took him out for dinner, and we became close friends, actually. So he came to me one night, he liked a drop of scotch, and then he said that maybe my institute, which specialized at the time in statistical living condition studies, I'm a sociologist, if we could do this in Gaza, which I thought was a great idea. But then I told him that we
had
to
do... If you could do what in Gaza, sorry?
To do a statistical living condition study on the living conditions amongst the population in Gaza. But then I said we have to do the same in the West Bank, and we have to do it in cooperation with the Israelis, and he went completely mad. But then I convinced him that we had to do it in some kind of cooperation. So then I went to Israel for the first time to talk to Israeli authorities about doing this living condition study. And these negotiations actually took several years. And so I got to know the leadership, both on the PLO and the Israeli leadership, through negotiating the permissions for this living condition study. And then the living condition study started. It was a massive thing with several hundred employees who did interviewing, et cetera, in Gaza and West Bank. So then Mona and I, we went for the first time to Gaza. I can't remember exactly which year it was. There was one particular scene which kind of burnt itself into us. And that was, we saw a scene between Palestinian youngsters who were throwing stones towards Israeli soldiers. Gaza was occupied by Israel at the time. But then we saw the Israeli soldiers, they were the same age as these youngsters who were throwing stones. And we saw the scary eyes of both of them. I mean, the occupier, I mean, these kids were just as scared as the Palestinians were. So we kind of thought, I mean, this is completely meaningless. Here you have these youngsters, and they're both looking at each other completely scared to death. And then we reached very soon the conclusion, or let me put it another way, I was asked at the time, and still, are you pro-Palestinian or are you pro-Israeli? And I always said, I'm pro-both. because there is a solution which is in both parties' interest. There is a win-win situation there. So we basically thought that this is meaningless, this whole conflict with these youngsters, etc. And that gave us a kind of a motivation for looking at it. And then 1991 came, and the so-called, which some of you might remember, the Madrid Peace Conference came, and negotiations started, facilitated by the Americans, formerly also by the Soviet Union at the time, but the Americans de facto facilitated it in Washington. And what I saw, I'll be brief now. So I knew then these characters who went to Washington to negotiate. And what was very striking was that I saw them on the CNN and I said something. And when I met them in Jerusalem, my Israeli friends, they told me exactly the opposite of what I'd been telling the CNN. So, I mean, I've got this feeling kind of there's something completely wrong here, because they were speaking to their own constituency. So the Palestinians were speaking to the Palestinians, and the Israelis were speaking to the Israelis, but they were not speaking to each other. They
were posturing. We have no idea what you're talking about.
So then the idea struck us that, I mean, these talks can never succeed. We have to get them off the cameras. It has to be secret talks where they don't have to speak to their own constituencies all the time. And then after about 1 year, we worked with the locals there. I also realized that without the PLO and Arafat, you can't make a deal, because they had the power to block everything. And de facto, the Palestinian negotiators, who were nominally not members of the PLO or Fatah, they were all of them reporting to Arafat. So he controlled, but he could not afford having a deal, which he himself was not a part of. That would be political suicide. So then, so our second most important conclusion was, we have to get Arafat on board. So in during Christmas in 1992, I flew to Tunis and met Arafat the first time. And it was a very dramatic meeting and throughout the night. But anyhow, and he then gave the go-ahead for the secret for the secret talks. And my counterpart in Israel was Yossi Beilin. He was then deputy foreign minister. So the Israelis, they sent two academics, Yossi Beilin and Ron Pundak, because they wanted to have deniability, also because it was illegal for Israelis to have contact with any representatives of the PLO. So they felt they couldn't send officials. And I was never fully aware if Paris was foreign minister, if he and Rabin were behind it, because they never made us privy to it until the 1st of May, actually, 1993, where the official Israelis came. And then, actually, frankly, to our surprise, both the Israelis and the Palestinians, they came to us and said, we want to do the deal in Oslo and not in Washington. But we will not tell the Americans, and we will not tell our delegations in Washington that what they actually are doing is just nonsense. And that came as a big surprise to us. But anyhow, so we did it. So it lasted from the beginning of January until the signing ceremony in Washington on the 13th of September, 1993.
It's fantastic. It's long amazing. Story. Really amazing. I just want more again. Sorry. Yeah. JT, so yeah. Can you tell us a little bit of the story, maybe that you heard from one side or the other, that would have inspired this scene?
Well, I'll tell you what's really interesting in the projects that I end up writing usually take a lot of research, and you sort of leap off and make it your own.
Mm-hmm.
But what's been very interesting about the story, we hear the story that Taya just told from his point of view. And normally when you're doing, as you would know better than I as a journalist, you know, when you're getting different people's points of view on an event, everyone has a different point of view, and you get the, as you probably all know, the Rashomon effect from Kurosawa's film, where everyone has a completely different experience or memory of a seminal event. But in a way, what was interesting to me is realizing midway through the researching this is that the story about these 9 or so months that the play takes place over, the principals and people around them as well who were involved all actually have the same story. That there's been contentious arguments among some people about who deserved more credit or what happened afterwards, and perhaps even some before. But the actual events of what happened when told in the memoirs and interviews with the Israeli negotiators, the Palestinian negotiators, with some of the Norwegian participants, Obviously, colors and differentiation, and my memory this, you remember that. But in terms of the key events, even down to sometimes actual conversations they had, remarkable consistency. So in some ways, that was freeing for me to say, well, in some ways, maybe I'll have to take even a little bit more license since we have such a strong grounding of agreed upon fact.
Mm-hmm. And so was this an actual event, or did you just...
Well, I mean, I've read the transcripts of when the first Uri Sevier meeting, which, you know, again, as you said, I had 3 hours to do 8 months, and I think the first meeting between Abu Allah and Uri, they went on for like 9 hours.
Right.
You know, with a long, formal speech,
mm-hmm.
because this was the first time that the Israeli government and the PLO had ever, in the history of either peoples, been in the same space. And there's a moment in the play which was very moving to me when I learned this as research, which I put in the play, when Abu Allah, who just met, is about to go meet an Israeli professor who appears earlier in the play, who's not an official representative the way Sevier is, but just a professor who's been sort of brought into this by Mona and Taya. And this, you know, legendary, larger-than-life figure in the PLO is nervous to go into a hotel room to meet with this Israeli liberal prof, and the Taya character says to him, why? And he said, because I've never met an Israeli face-to-face. Mm. And that sort of dynamism. So I wanted to capture some of that, too, in this scene, where I'm compressing it and theatricalizing it. But it's that stuff of larger-than-life events as a writer. You want to write scenes and plays about people who are having those defining moments at which they, as people, will be changed forever.
Did any of them not want to talk to you, or was...
You know, I very quickly decided not to talk to people. As I work, I think like a lot of playwrights, that there's a musicality to language, and you want to create the rhythm of people's speech patterns that you can evoke, and sort of the alchemy of writing. And so I learned everything I could about all of them to the point where I felt like I knew them personally, but then most of them I never spoke to. And then it's been odd, like a character you're going to meet, Il Singer, that Bartle introduced a little bit, who's in the third scene we see, who was an Israeli negotiator who comes in the third act. When he came and spoke to the actors, it was very difficult for me because I wanted to call him, yo, and how are you, and how's your wife? But he, you know, I'm just some stalker to him. He doesn't know who I am. So it's a funny thing, the alchemy of writing, where you both need to learn something really well and then keep it very far away so you can create your event.
Who did you meet?
I met Taya, I met Mona, I met housekeepers who appear in the play.
Mm-hmm.
I met Secret Service agents who appear in the play.
But not the Israelis.
But no, and also, and I get that was part of it too, because I wanted to be able to envision them in a way that I could make them both as theatrical, you know, the stage has much more intense requirements than real life.
Yeah.
But also I wanted to deep, not that I wouldn't of the real people, I'm about to say, but I'm only interested in putting people on stage that I love or admire. And it's not that I wouldn't admire, I admire everyone involved in this, but I wanted to filter them through me so that by making them artificial, I could make them more human.
Yeah.
If that makes sense.
Right.
We did. We also met Perez.
And we met Perez.
Taya,
yeah.
Mm-hmm. Introduced us to Perez. He was very supportive, so.
Yeah.
What was, Bart, what was the most interesting reaction you had from any of the people that came to see it who were involved?
Well, I think overall, the piece is very even-handed,
mm-hmm.
in terms of both the position of the Israelis and the Palestinians. So we haven't had any terrible reactions from either, which is great.
Mm-hmm.
We felt like one of the big goals was to tell this piece of history and allow both the arguments of both sides to really resonate without favoring one side over the other, so that we could do what the artist should be doing, which is talking about what happened and allow people to make their own decisions about it. So we've met millions of people who were very affected by it or, you know, moved by it. Often, especially at Lincoln Center, when we were doing it at the Mitzi Newhouse, many of the older audiences, you would see very strong reactions by the end of the piece. Of people who lived through that time,
mm-hmm.
who have been invested in that particular struggle for a long time, people very, very, very intensely moved by Rabin's speech, which is at the end.
Yeah.
And that's been very powerful. Mm-hmm. So.
And the Palestinians, what have their reactions been?
Similarly, I mean, I'm pausing like, because the moment you say something nice about your play, then you'll be punished, you know, by the gods. But yeah, I mean, my intention, both of our intention in the production and the actors, who are, as you've seen tonight, are, I mean, an extraordinary ensemble of performers who've had a real imprint on the sort of shape and form of the play. And myself wanted to, you know, it's not, if one side is right and one side is wrong, then that's not a play.
Yeah.
You know, oh, it's a tragedy, it's a right and a right for theater purposes. And so, obviously, I was very anxious. You know, I don't like to be yelled at, as most people don't, and that's the opposite of the effect I wanted. So I was super pleasantly surprised and moved at the sense of excitement or relief. You know, some people I think have spoken to me how they were so relieved that they were not caricatures. Mm-hmm. You know, which is very poignant. Or descriptions that Bart has of people being very moved. Or people who were diplomats. We've had a lot of diplomats from the UN come, and it's been such a sensation at the UN, the sense of, yes, this is what we do.
Right.
That one night, you know, the Beaumont, the theater we're doing at Lincoln Center now is 1,100 seats, and on May 5th, the entire audience is going to be the UN.
That's so
great. That's pretty geekily cool, I have to say. That's pretty cool.
And so a lot of colleagues of Taya, Ban Ki-moon, and other people were very, very positive. And I think that sort of the deeper point of it is what he talks about is the spirit of Oslo, is the process of Oslo. Mm-hmm. And Taya wouldn't say this, but if we had any theme we were trying to get across, it's how it's possible and that there is hope for implacable enemies to find common ground and possibly come to good solutions that benefit everybody. It's a very bleak prospect in the United States at this moment, but it's one of those things where...
Maybe we can learn from the play.
I will say, though, it's been really interesting because we're doing the play again, and I've not changed any words in any way, of course, because of the political upheaval we're living in. But it's added this, and we've talked to the actors, we've talked a lot about in rehearsal, right, guys? That it's just, it's like there's an entire new layer to the play, because a play that's about implacable, about sort of heroic people trying to bring implacable foes together, which was such a historical and out of the United States experience, now seems ever so domestic.
Yeah.
So it's been a very powerful thing to be rehearsing it at this moment.
It's great. It's really...
I had a few notes, but I won't go into them right now.
Feel free. We'd love to see your process.
No.
Taya, tell me, did any of this happen like this, in particularly the question over legitimacy versus existence? And
I mean, it didn't happen exactly
like
it was played now, but I think it crystallizes very nicely what actually happened.
And Abu Allah was not calling Tunis?
No. So so he always went to his room, and he was sitting there for an hour or 1.5 hours to the irritation of everybody. And then he came back and said, I've got new instructions from Chairman Arafat. And actually, the Israelis played exactly the same game. They could walk out and say, we talked to Rabin, and they hadn't even lifted off the telephone. So it was great game playing. And what I also think is caught very well here is, to put it in another, personalities matter. Mm-hmm. And because these were, the negotiators here were and are, absolutely outstanding negotiators and very strong personalities. Mm-hmm. And it was one thing, which maybe is not coming, but I think it's another scene, that they shared a tremendous sense of humor. So, I mean, they were laughing and cracking jokes and telling stories all the time. And so, in a way, they started as adversaries, and they ended up as very close friends. And actually, they are friends until this day. And here, what we Norwegians tried to do was to, in a way, we did the opposite of what everything which happened in Washington. In Washington, I think at the heyday of the talks in Washington, there were 160 delegates on each side. And they stayed at different, one delegation stayed in the, somewhere in the Pentagon, and the other one stayed in at the hotels in central Washington. We told them that we will not allow the delegations to be larger than five, preferably three on each side, and you will have to live in the same house. You have to eat breakfast together every day, lunch and dinner, and have drinks in the evening. You have to live with each other in a secluded house. So, because confidence and trust isn't an institutional thing, it's a personal thing. So we had to nourish the personalities and make the personalities believe that the other guy was in good faith. And this was what was achieved in a period from January to May. Then both of them believed that the other guys really wanted to truly to make a peace agreement. And that's when the real negotiations started, actually 1st of May 1993, where Uri Zevir and Joel Zinger came in. And I mean, these were larger than life personalities. And Joel Zinger was the kind of meticulous lawyer drafter, while Uri Zevir was the kind of master charmer negotiator. And his Hassan Asfour, who's sitting over there, he was a communist, and a very kind of radical communist, and he was a kind of ideologue behind there. And this kind of combination of these characters were absolutely, so we were in a way, we were very lucky to have those characters in there, and our job was in a way to turn the image of an enemy into the image of a friend. So what we did, for instance, was that we brought Abu Ala's wife and two sons together with Uri Zevir's daughter. So it was a kind of family, we made it into a kind of family affair in order to forge these personal relations. Later when the implementation of Oslo started, also we were lucky to have Yitzhak Rabin and Shimon Peres on one side, and actually Arafat and Peres, they had numerous of meetings after the signing of Oslo, and I attended hundreds of them, and they actually also developed a personal rapport. I wouldn't say it was a friendship, but because it wasn't, but it was a kind of mutual respect there. And also with Rabin, though he was less directly involved himself. So on the political side, it was very much a Shimon Peres show with Arafat. He always called Arafat Mr. Chairman, and Arafat always called him Your Excellency. So, but all the others were first name. So anyhow.
There's a wonderful scene that you wrote, JT, where I believe they're really taking Taya on and kind of taking him, giving him a real beating. And I think it comes from Zevir, right?
Yeah.
And
yeah.
Zevir then pretends to be Arafat, right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And then you have Taya surprise them by pretending to be Rabin. And it's this.
Well, now you gave that away. Okay.
And it's this. It's this. I'm assuming you made it up because
yes,
it's so wonderfully dramatic at that moment where he becomes the focus of all their rage and.
But he was anyway.
He was anyway.
In the position, they would rip into Terry a lot. Although I mean, from what he
right.
can explain it better, but
yeah,
you know, and they were very hard on him, and they did act out each other's. They acted out each
other's.
Well,
they do. They, I mean, it's interesting. Right. It's a perfect example of the difference between the reality and the theatricalized fiction. So you talked to me when we first met about how they were, and Mona talked about how they were just, they had to let their frustrations out. They couldn't do it on each other, so he became the punching bag.
Right.
And you read through sources, and they sort of begrudgingly admit in their memoirs, oh, yes, we were terrible too. You know, you think, wow, that's, yeah. If you'd admit that, that must have been pretty bad. So you take that. And you think, all right, well, and then, as you said, and they talk in the books, they tell stories and they tell jokes, much of which is in especially the first act. So then as the author, you think, well, what is the most
extreme sort of dangerous thing you could do is, what would it be like for each side to be the other's, you know, Kaiser Soze, you know, to see, you know, because I didn't want to put the most powerful people, you know, it's always most effective, like not showing violence, actual violence on stage, to show the most powerful people, to not have them appear, but only have their shadow on stage is more powerful. But this way I could bring them into the room in a way that was fun and also a little dangerous.
If I may, during these kind of negotiations, the third party has to become the lightning rod, because you have to kind of direct the aggressions against yourself and not towards the parties themselves. So in a way, you become the common enemy of the two parties, instead of they playing out their animosities towards each other.
Right.
You become the lightning rod. So, and it was, that was kind of probably the most difficult and emotionally demanding part of it. And because, I mean, there were so strong emotions, and they took out all their rages, particularly against me. And that in a way, we invited to it, because it was necessary in order to find somebody else to take out all those aggressions. But again, I mean, humor played an incredibly important role. I had to underline that once again. So we, the negotiators and ourselves, we competed on making the most funny imitations of Arafat and Paris in particular, the two. And we were, and so we were, I mean, Abdullah was incredibly good at imitating Perez. Uri was fantastic in imitating Shimon Perez. So they kind of made fun of their own leaders to the others. And that is, it was very interesting, very, very interesting dynamic there. And I think this is caught very well.
So you never actually played Rabin to them?
Yes, of course.
Oh, you did?
But I was better at playing Paris and Arafat.
You were.
So they were howling of laughter when we did our... So it's... I can't underline that enough, that, I mean, it's very much a personal thing. So you have to build the relationship between the personalities. And whereas Sevier and Abola are very close friends today. And they're seeing
That's
each
great.
Other frequently. I think they speak once a week. I mean, in the ebbs and flows of what is happening there, that friendship has stayed for all of those years. And the families are seeing each other, et cetera. So it's pretty pretty remarkable.
I have to ask you this, which, you know, with all the hope, right, we also have the ending where we hear what happens in the ensuing years. And the beginning of the next intifada, and having lived through all of this and worked, you know, given your life for it to some extent, how did you feel to watch those years unravel everything that had happened? Or do you feel that it hasn't?
No, I mean, what is Oslo? Oslo is, in a way, if I may use that word, an ideology. It's the two-state solution, mm-hmm. which lives on. It's kind of universally, more or less. More or less, maybe not so much.
I don't know about that.
Maybe not so much in Washington these days, but anyhow, I mean, just a couple of months ago, I mean, there was a meeting. I can't remember how many foreign ministers from all over the world who were there. You unanimously agreed that the two-state solution is the only way to go, and I think Mr. Trump also opened up for it in one of his tweets the other day. So in a way, that ideology still is there. And then what Oslo did was, Oslo is an ideology, two-state solution, but it's also an institution, namely the Palestinian Authority, which exists today, and which is basically running social and economic affairs, and in parts of the West Bank also security, until this day. And you have a government, a president, a prime minister, ministers, ministries. They run hospitals and social services, etc. So all this is standing. And the paradox of the matter is that this is equally in Israel's interest as it is in the Palestinian interest. Because if Israel had to reoccupy Gaza and the West Bank, then the occupying power would have all these responsibilities. And there's billions and billions and billions of dollars every year which Israel had to pay and administer. So the existence of the Palestinians is deeply in Israel's interest and deeply in the Palestinian interest. And even if the to go to the negotiating, even if that has been, frozen for so many years now, still opinion polls show steadily that there is on and off there is a majority for the two-state solution, both on the Palestinian and on the Israeli side. But let me end by saying that Oslo would not have been possible without the remarkable courage of the leaders. Yeah. Because if before Oslo, if there had been an opinion poll about the principles which came out, I mean, I'm sure there would have been kind of 90% of the Palestinians that would have been against it, but and equally on the Israeli side. But they had the courage to do it and then put it to the people. And public opinion swung immediately. Mm-hmm. So they shaped public opinion. They didn't follow public opinion. And this was the greatness of Peres and Rabin and Arafat, but also that they dared to do it and bring it to the people afterwards. And it was brought to a vote in the Knesset. Mm-hmm. Let me just add one thing here. Without the Oslo agreement, there would never have been a peace agreement with Jordan. And that peace agreement is standing still. Yeah. And without the peace agreement with Jordan, Israel would not have been able to end the occupation of southern Lebanon and reach an agreement, which I actually negotiated on behalf of the UN, with the Lebanese and the Syrians to end their occupation, which was approved by the Security Council. And Bashar al-Assad had 45,000 troops standing in Lebanon, and he was, and I was also the negotiator there, this is the only deal he has ever made internationally, which he stood by. He withdrew 45,000 troops from Lebanon. Think about it today, if there were 45,000 Syrian troops in Lebanon. So Oslo had effects beyond the Palestinian-Israeli story, which has been very much for the good. So I'm still a defender of Oslo.
Well, I think the ending of the play very much does that. You have you have both hope, and I think that's what you were trying to do, right?
Can I just wanted to add one other thing here. Now, I think what is, of course, as you saw, the foreign minister of Norway, the incoming, he thought we were crazy. he thought we were completely insane, dared to put our noses into, and more than that, into probably the most difficult conflict in the world. I think also, you have to dare.
Yeah.
And you have to think the unthinkable and do what everybody thinks is undoable. And I think this is one of the most important lessons of Oslo today. Because with the chaos and anarchy and misery we are seeing today, there is still hope. Because if it was possible to do that some 20 years ago, it's still possible to do things. And when I, with my good friend Ehud Barak, negotiated Israel's withdrawal from Lebanon, everybody thought we were crazy.
Yes.
And when I went to Damascus and negotiated with Assad, I thought I was a fool. But it's possible.
Thank you so much, Taya. Thank you so much, JT. Thank you so much, Bart. Thank you all for coming. And you should all go see the play.